Well, hello everyone, and welcome to our webinar today. We are so excited that you have joined us for Kentucky Spins Tuesday Tips. Today we are going to be discussing sensory processing challenges and provide you with some wonderful tips that I believe will be very helpful for you. We have a very special guest speaker, Amanda Bruce. I'll be telling you a little bit more about her in just a few moments. But before we get started, I would like to welcome everyone. I am Stella Beard. I am with Kentucky Spin, and we are happy that you have joined us. But I want to tell you just a little bit about Kentucky Spin before we get into all the details of the webinar and I go over a little bit of housekeeping things with you. Kentucky Spin is the Special Parent Involvement Network, and we are the Parent Training and Information Center, or the PTI, for the state of Kentucky. We've actually been the PTI in Kentucky since 1988 for well over 30 years, and we actually just received funding again for another 5 years, so we're very excited about that. So that enables us to continue to provide information and support for children and youth with all types of disabilities, birth through age 26, and we work with parents, families, and professionals, and so we're very excited that we get to continue that work here in Kentucky. A little bit about what we do not do is we do not act as attorneys. So we are not giving legal advice to families. We're not telling them, giving them our opinions or what we think they should do. But what we are doing is we're empowering families to effectively advocate for their children. And we provide that peer support to help families access needed information and resources. So we can kind of do the legwork for them. So when a family calls us, we can help them find the resources that they need, give them some tools that they need to be better advocates for their children, and help empower them to begin to interact with their teachers and staff and help them understand that special education process a little bit better. And this slide right here we have up on all of our webinars, and it says, "Together we can accomplish great things for our children. And none of us have all the answers, but we are all working through this pandemic and adjusting as we go." So just a little bit of housekeeping before our wonderful speaker joins us. On the right-hand side of your screen, you will see a dashboard. There is a little section called handouts. You will see a little arrow that points to the right. And when you click on that little arrow, it'll drop down and you have two handouts there. One is a handout that Amanda has provided today, and the other is the PowerPoint presentation that we will be using today. You are free to download that now and save it, or we will be sending an email out later this afternoon to everyone who attends the webinar, and so you will be able to download it then if you don't have time to do it right now. Also, throughout the presentation, if you have a question, you will also see another arrow by the word questions. If you click on that little arrow, it will drop down the box, and you can type in that question box, and we will see it. I also have a couple of colleagues on the call with me, Kelly and Michaela, and they will also be helping monitor those questions throughout the presentation. So please feel free and drop those questions in there, and we will have Amanda answer those for you. So I'm happy to say we have Amanda Bruce, who is a low incident consultant, and she can explain a little bit about that and what her role is at the Ohio Valley Educational Cooperative. Throughout the state, we have special education cooperatives all around. And so Amanda works for the Ohio Valley Educational Cooperative. So we are so happy that she has joined us today. So Amanda, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. I am super happy to be back with you all again today. I really cherish the partnerships that we are building with Kentucky Spin through the educational cooperatives here in the state. By working together, we make it better for everyone. So my role as low incidence consultant is I primarily work with teachers and administrators who work with those students with autism, significant cognitive disabilities, and I also work in the compliance realm. So I talk a lot about IEPs and general paperwork and those kinds of things for districts. I've been with OVEC for about 3.5 years now, and I what we work really hard to do is to find ways to support our schools so that they can also help support our parents. I do serve the 14 districts surrounding Jefferson County, and I partner with Jefferson County's low incidence consultant also to work with that district. All right, I think we're ready to get started, Stella.
Wonderful. And I will let everyone know there's a small little delay when we do put the slides up. So just be aware of that as we go through the presentation. Thank you, Amanda.
Thank you, Stella. So today we're going to be talking about sensory processing challenges and tips. Sensory processing is very near and dear to my heart. We all at some level experience sensory processing challenges. For some of our children, our students, they may have a more heightened sensory processing challenge than we experience. I'm also going to, at the end, we'll go through a little bit some different, what it really means to have sensory processing, what that looks like, and then we're going to talk about some tips and some easy things that you can do to address those sensory processing challenges, especially as we go into the holiday season. I think it's really important during this time, even if you're not traveling or having large groups or even a few family members over during the COVID-19 crisis, it's important to remember just the decorations and such can be a sensory processing challenge for our friends. So, as we explained earlier, I am a consultant for the Ohio Valley Educational Cooperative. I was a moderate to severe disabilities teacher for over 10 years. I am a mom to four. Both of my adult children are married. I have two grandbabies. They are 2.5 and almost one. I'm very grateful the camera is not on today because I was finishing up sewing my granddaughter's dolls that she's getting for her birthday, and I am covered in fluff. I keep finding it everywhere. I am also the sibling of an adult with disabilities. My brother, he's about 41 and lives with me and has autism, Tourette's, and mental health concerns. And then I'm married to a spouse with Asperger's syndrome. So needless to say, I live and breathe this information on a regular basis. All right, Stella, I think we can go ahead and move forward. And as we start to go into this concept of sensory processing, what we're going to look at is really, what does it mean? What does it look like? How do we deal with it, et cetera? So one of the quotes that you'll see here in just a minute is, sensory processing refers to the way the nervous system receives messages from the senses and turns them into responses. People with sensory processing challenges, the information goes in the brain, but it doesn't get organized into appropriate responses. So what we will see is either an oversensitivity to things in the environment or an undersensitivity to those things in the environment. And I think that's really important to remember in the media, and often what we may see portrayed, even in training videos for sensory processing, we will see hypersensitivities, those oversensitivities to certain things. But what we have to remember is there are also those undersensitivity things that can impact a person just as much. On the next slide, we're going to take a look at a little video that explains sensory processing in one of the best ways that I've seen. The little cartoon is actually out of England, which I have said for a long time that I think England's a little further ahead than we are here in the U.S. sometimes in responses to these things. So in the video, what you're going to see is kind of what it looks like.
you will see oversensitivities and undersensitivities. After we watch the video, what we will do is we will move directly in to talk about those hypersensitivities. And as I have grown as an educator and as a sibling, a spouse, a parent, what I've found is that it's much more complex than I thought. All right, let's take a look at the video.
I've clicked it, so let's give it just a second.
Absolutely. And this is what I love about technology, is it's wonderful that we can connect, and then it just has its moments. And here we go.
Quiet library, or studying for a big test, but something is distracting you. You lose focus on your work and instead are only thinking about that now. Your senses are trying to perceive the sound harmoniously, but instead it causes chaos in your brain and it won't stop. Eventually you give up on studying altogether. This is a common experience, but for many, this lack of harmony happens so frequently that it affects their ability to live their daily life. This is known as sensory processing disorder, or SPD. It's seen most often in children or those with autism. SPD can present itself in several ways, but it's usually a combination of over-responsiveness and under-responsiveness. Over-responders are overly sensitive to certain sensory inputs, creating a sense of chaos. If a child is oversensitive to the feel of clothing, he might avoid wearing coats, even in a snowstorm. Under-responders aren't sensitive enough to their environment. They seek out more intense sensations to produce a reaction. These children might be constantly fidgeting and moving in class. They may ignore their work and even their own safety. This internal lack of harmony can lead to negative behaviors, anxiety, social difficulties, and trouble focusing. But SPD can be overcome. An occupational therapist can provide sensory integration therapy and modifications to help someone with SPD manage their day-to-day life. Through intervention, modifications, and support, someone with SPD can function harmoniously once again.
All right, wonderful. Thank you, Stella. So I think what's really important about this video, and what's really important to see in this video, is that this is really common. We all experience this. You don't have to have a diagnosis of sensory processing disorder to experience some of those oversensitivities and undersensitivities. So where we're going to start today are with these hypersensitivities. We're going to talk about hypervision, hyperhearing, olfactory hypersensitivities, that's smell, hypertactile, which is touch, vestibular and proprioceptive hypersensitivities. I can't even say it. In these last two, I think what's really important, this is about how our bodies move in space. You may experience in an IEP meeting, an occupational therapist or a physical therapist, or even a speech language pathologist talking about this vestibular and proprioceptive hypersensitivities or hyposensitivities. We're going to talk about it so that you can see what it actually looks like. So let's dive right into hypervision on the next slide. And I think this is really important. I talked about the fluff all over myself today, putting the stall together. My husband keeps going, what is that? And it's because he's hyper-focused on that. You may have a student that talks about those dust particles that fly in the air. They see every single little thing, almost to a microscopic level. A lot of times you'll see that bright lights or flashes of light aren't comfortable, or they have a very high dislike for that. That's what I like to talk about when we have holiday lights up. I don't have anything that flashes. Both my husband and my brother and even my grandson have hypersensitivity to that.
My mom doesn't have sensory processing disorder, but she has lupus. And so it's the same concept. She now has some hypervision sensitivities. So we have to think about that. The other big thing are fluorescent lights. So what you may see with students who have hypervision is when they're in a school classroom all day under those fluorescent lights, if they aren't dimmed or muted in some way, it can actually be so hard for them to process that in addition to whatever else they're needing to process that you see challenging behaviors. So this is really important to think about this, even if your child or student doesn't exhibit these fully. If they do have some of these sensitivities, we're going to talk about how we can address that. All right, let's look at the next one. And I hope you guys enjoy. I tried to pick a Thanksgiving themed background, and you will see my Bitmojis are, I tried to theme them with the slides, but I get a little Bitmoji happy. So I do apologize if that is distracting to you. I do apologize. It's hard to hear. Hopefully, let me adjust my microphone briefly.
I believe they were saying it was hard to hear when the video was playing, Amanda.
Thank you.
I had it cranked all the way up, but for some reason it was difficult to hear. And as you start talking about hyperhearing, I will share that my son Clayton has, I think would be the same thing, it's hypersensitivity. And so as a young child, well, a baby actually, when he was born, he has a disability called Williams syndrome. And that is one of the characteristics of Williams syndrome. But one of the things too, he failed his hearing test as a baby when he was born. And it's because he could not, we found out later that it was the hypersensitivity. And it's because those high frequency sounds, he hears extremely well, but of course they were not, it was not showing up on any hearing test that he had. And so he always failed it. And even to this day, he still fails every hearing test that he takes.
Well, and I think that's so interesting because my daughter has the opposite problem. She had hyperhearing. She could hear really well, but then we would go through these huge spells where she would act like she couldn't hear. Well, she's actually partially deaf in one of her ears. And so what was happening is if we were on her right side, she had hyperhearing because it was very clear to the point, it was almost painful. But if we were on her left side, she couldn't hear us hardly at all. So I think that's what's really important is that regardless of who you are, you may experience this or your child may experience this. And it's just a different way of thinking. Hyperhearing, I think, is very interesting. I have this issue. I'm a very, very light sleeper. I just actually had a sleep study and they were cracking up about how light of a sleeper I am. But this is where you'll see that startle response, even in students as they grow older out of that toddler stage. And I think that's really important to understand because, again, it's about any sudden noises or stuff keeping, it's better to err on the side of a lower volume and adjust with closed captioning or something to try to mitigate that. Thunderstorms, crowds, haircuts, any of those loud motor noises. And sometimes what you'll see is you may have a student who hums. They may hum, they may mutter under their breath. They may even make sing-song noises under their breath or out loud to compensate for this hyperhearing. And I think that's really important because I know when I was in the classroom, we would often look at those repetitive sound noises as, oh, they're coping with something. What do we have to fix? Well, actually, it was all environmental. There wasn't something that the student needed addressed. We needed to adjust the environment to allow them to be able to function and not have to have this process over top of everything else. All right, Stella, let's take a look at the next one. Olfactory or smell. This was always fascinating. They either couldn't tolerate how people or objects smelled. They may run away from smells. And my favorite that I always had with my students is they want to wear the same outfit all the time. Like, it's difficult to get them off and washed. This is really, really common. And it has to do with comfort because they understand the smell. And that can be a really big challenge, especially, you know, working with a school system or working with other groups, because they may not understand what that means. Smells of food, it's too strong. My brother at times when we are cooking, garlic is the primary offender, but he actually will wear a mask in the house and has for years to compensate for that. He has done that as a way to compensate and still feel socially accepted. So mask wearing has been a big hit in our house. The other thing is you may see younger students or even some older students take their shirt and put it up over their nose. That may indicate that they are having some type of smell hypersensitivity, and you might not even smell it. I think that's one thing to really kind of consider, is just because you can't smell it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. And you know, you usually see some food sensitivities with this, where they have a very limited diet, etc. So I think what's important about this is, again, as you have those holiday meals that have many different smells, you may have holiday scents you have out in a wax warmer or an air spray or a candle. If you are noticing some of these behaviors, you may need to adjust that. Let's take a look at the next one. And I apologize if I sneeze. I had a sinus infection last week. And so sometimes I sneeze uncontrollably. So hypertactile, this has to do with that touch. This is probably a really common thing. You may see they don't want to be hugged. They don't want to be touched because it makes them panic. This is another big thing. Hair washing, cutting nails. It's a big deal. It's some of those basic hygiene things that if those are a hypersensitivity, you really have to figure that out. Same thing with clothes. If they have a limited clothing choice because of the fabrics, that can be a challenge. And the other thing is that hot and cold, messy, the coat battle. I had several students who would battle the coat during the winter and even the fall, because they could not stand having something else constraining them. Same thing with shoes. I can say, as a teacher, I was really bad about this until I had better understanding. I wanted my kids' shoes on because that was safety. We're going to wear those shoes. That's what's socially acceptable. Well, guess what? Sometimes shoes are terrible. And the more I thought about it is, I go barefoot most of the time if I'm not at work or in public. So, because I don't like anything on my feet. Well, guess what? That's actually a tactile issue. It's just not to the level that we may see with someone who's having those sensory processing challenges. Again, something to consider and to find that balance. All right, let's take a look at a couple more here. And I always like this particular Bitmoji on this slide, because I do still cut the crust off. So the reason I chose potato for this particular picture is these are kiddos who may just plop. And it's because they don't know where they are in space. So they have trouble walking, changing directions. They're usually poor at sports. They get disoriented more so than you would typically see if they were spinning, jumping, or running. And oftentimes they will dig their heels in because they don't want to leave the ground. They're terrified of that. I saw this a lot with my students, and it literally, all vestibular means is it's how we move in space. And so my students who didn't understand their space, we couldn't work on things to make them more independent. So we had to learn, how do we address that? Well, you take baby steps. It's a slow process, but they can eventually work through this. And then the last one in hypersensitivities is going to be that proprioceptic. And proprioceptic has to do with how we bend. And I didn't really understand this when my OTs and my PTs first explained it to me. But it really has to do with being disoriented when you have to bend or move, not in a straight line. So when that slide pops up, I'll explain it briefly, and then we're going to move into those hyposensitivities. And with the hyposensitivities, what we will see is that the hyposensitivities are the same areas as we see. So you can see leaning here for the proprioceptic. They hold bodies in odd positions. This is where a lot of your fine motor control comes in. And so, again, it's just that movement. You will see oftentimes line up, sit up straight. They're not capable of that. And we have to teach them, and we have to look and find the ways that they're comfortable. And I think that's really important, that a student can be attentive, but not sitting up straight. When I look at myself in meetings, and it's been interesting on the camera, I slouch a lot, but I'm more comfortable that way. So if I'm presenting, like even now, you all can't see me, but I have 1 foot on the ground, 1 foot cocked up under me, because that's most comfortable for me to be able to speak, because I speak a lot with my hands, I speak a lot with my body language. So that's okay. Everybody's different, and it's okay to think about those things. So now as we move into the hyposensitivities, you're going to see it's the same areas. So we're going to talk about vision. Before we move on,
we do have a question about this.
Yes.
It says,
yeah.
what are some accommodations for children that experience hypersensitivity to fluorescent lighting in the classroom? And then I'll switch the slide so you'll be ready to move on.
Yeah, so that's a great question. And so one of the things that you can do in some schools is basically we bought these cloths that were very light greens, light purples, light oranges that had magnets, and they just clicked onto the metal frame of the light, and it dulled the light in the room. The other thing you can do is we used a lot of floor lamps. So one of the buildings I worked in, fire marshal wouldn't let us do that with the magnet cloth. So what we had to do was we would actually turn all of the fluorescence off, and we would have three or four floor lamps that had pastel colored globes on them. And we would have those positioned throughout the room in our instructional areas. So the room was a bit darker. We had windows, so we were able to open the shades. But we had a much lower light because that helped all of us. We were able to focus more. We were able to take away the temptation of turning the lights off and on. Those are two really quick and easy ways to handle it. The other thing is, if you have the option to section off your room in a classroom where you can have fluorescence on in one space and off in another, that works really well too. Did that answer the question?
Yes, I'm sure that did. That was great information. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. So as you see, as we move into these hyposensitivities, we've got the same six areas again: vision, hearing, taste and smell, tactile, which is just that feeling, and then that movement, the vestibular and proprioceptive movement. So we can go ahead and hop to that next slide. And if you guys will bear with me about 10 minutes to get through this, then we'll get into the toolbox and the resources. So hypovision is where they don't really see. They may almost look like they have a vision impairment, but it's really because they aren't able to zone in on things. So they may only see outlines. They may run their hands over the edges. They may stare at lights. You may see infants at times stare at lights or stare at fans, stare at reflections. This is really common. So Christmas tree lights. My one-year-old granddaughter is fascinated with them. But I have a student who's also fascinated with them and has them all over his room year-round because of his sensory needs. This is really important. When they're in unfamiliar environments, they may walk around and touch everything before they settle down. We have to be okay with that. I think sometimes in the effort of structure, we try to settle students much more quickly than we may need to. It's okay to walk around an unfamiliar space. I don't know about you all, but I do the same thing. I may not touch everything, but if I enter a new office space, I may look around, kind of figure out where are the doors, where are the windows, does it have a restroom? Same concept, it's just on a much more focused scale. And you may see students move fingers or objects in front of their eyes to stimulate that vision. One thing I would talk with your therapist about, either your occupational therapist or your teachers, is have this conversation about whether or not any visual impairment needs do exist. It's really hard with students with hypovision sensitivities to determine that sometimes, but it would be worth investigating. Bauer Sox Vision Care in the Louisville area does some amazing stuff with vision therapy, and I've read a lot of their research, and I've had one former student get vision therapy, and it was amazing the difference that it made. And it really came down to desensitizing the student with some of their sensory processing issues with hypovision. So just something to explore if you believe your student or child is having that issue. All right, let's take a look at hypohearing. So this is our students who may seek out sounds. They may take the iPad and play that same sound over and over and over. I had one student in my high school classroom who liked the Shining Twins. Needless to say, that was behavior that I found a replacement for with a different sound very quickly. But he needed that. That was part of his ability to process when we were doing literacy work. He had that sound to deal with the sensory processing so he could concentrate, and it was phenomenal. He actually learned to read simple books for the first time ever. So it was just a matter of finding a balance for him. You may find students that like to flush the toilet, run that water. I was blessed in my classroom to always have a kitchen sink for different activities that we did. So sometimes we would run the water, or sometimes my bathrooms in my classroom where I worked had a dressing room. We'd sit in the dressing room and work because they needed that sensory balance for themselves. You may also see students that like to crumple hand, or they make rhythmic noises like tapping or banging. Again, these are all things that happen. We all do it, just sometimes not to the degree or level that a person with a sensory processing challenge might have. So there's ways to turn this into really neat things. There was a video on Facebook this weekend that talked about a teacher that gave a young man who was doing a lot of this tapping drumsticks, and he's a professional drummer now. So those are all things to help channel that sensory input in a way that can be productive. All right, so let's take a look at the next one.
One quick question. Is it possible to experience both hypersensitivity and hyposensitivity at the same time?
It can happen, yes. What we see with our students with autism in particular, they may cycle through. So they may start out as having a hypersensitivity that goes hypo in it, and they may switch back and forth. I think when that happens, that's where usually there's another trigger that's coming from that. And the best thing to do in that case is usually try to address the hyper first and then the hypo, simply because the hyper could be more pronounced than the hypo, and the hyper is a little easier to address than hypo. Does that make any sense whatsoever?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Yeah. So when you have students that do that, it's a challenge. I'm not going to lie. It's a challenge. But the way I always started with was if I had seen some hyper mixed with some hypo, I always address the hyper first. So hypervision, hyperhearing, I'd get those lights down first thing. We'd limit the smells. We would switch to a calming activity. Usually so that we could find a balance for that. Hypotaste and hyposmell, typically they chew and smell everything they can. Students with this particular sensitivity can at times exhibit pica, which is where a student may eat or ingest items that are not food. And this is hard. The licking, the mouthing, playing with faces, regurgitation. These are challenging. Most behavior therapists and occupational therapists I have worked with, this is the hardest sensory processing issue to deal with. And typically, you never try to stop the behavior, but we try to find things that are more socially acceptable and safer. So if they like to chew everything, give them chewing gum. If they want to smell everything, give them a small thing of essential oils they can smell. Playing with feces, there are whole protocols for teaching that. I had a student who had that issue. She does not anymore. She's doing great. But that took us a long time to figure out what the sensitivity was. The regurgitation is a scary one. And my student who had that issue had sensory processing disorder. He actually had several hypo and hyper and would switch back and forth. But the regurgitation started as a way to process his displeasure at an activity. Unfortunately, what it became is it helped him deal with his anxiety and some other things. Medically, there was nothing wrong. But to help with that, he was started on some, I think it's Prilosec and some other antacids that did help. We also tried to look at his diet, try to create a calm environment for him. Unfortunately, it's one we've never been able to totally help. He does it a lot less than he used to, but he still struggles with that and has some pretty serious medical conditions from now at this point. If you have a student who has the regurgitation sensory processing challenge, it's really, really important to work with your behavior therapist, your doctors, and your occupational therapist to really try to find some way to reduce that if possible. But I do really understand how challenging that is. And if anyone has a student that has that particular issue, I have a whole separate thing on that that I can share with you, some research and different plans that we did to try to help with it. So we can go on to the next slide. Hypotactility, this is where they don't feel pain or temperature, which is really, really scary. Again, it's a process that takes time. It takes training. If they're self-injurious, it's really about teaching those replacement behaviors. Pressure, like pressure vests, tight clothing, carrying heavy backpacks or heavy work, you may hear. Those are all things that work really great to help offset this. Tight hugs. We had what was called the brain slug. Our student would ask for it, or our students. And basically, it was a way to squeeze their hands. And we called it the brain slug to make it more fun and more socially acceptable, because the kids were watching a cartoon called Futurama at the time. And they had brain slugs that mimicked the behavior that we were doing. Hypotactility is just as common as hypertactility. And it really comes down to teaching replacement behaviors for this one. All right, Stella, we can go to the next. And again, if you have a student that is doing self-injurious behavior, I have a whole separate set of things that could help with that. I think it's interesting that regurgitation and self-injurious behavior are really almost sensory processing things all of their own, and are really challenging. All right, so I'll go to these next two kind of quickly so that we can get over to the toolkit. These are kiddos that spin, or they don't know where they are in space. They're floppy. They have low tone. Again, they tend to fall down a lot. These two are really important. This is where you introduce small exercises, typically with an occupational therapist or even a physical therapist, to kind of help the person learn how to move within their space. Again, these are very common. Let's go ahead and go to the next slide. And I apologize, I have the hiccups a little bit. So you all have copies of these, but what I kind of want to go through quickly on these next couple of slides is just some of the highlights of tips on how to deal with this. So these tips are good for hyper or hypo. So we talked a few minutes ago, can they exhibit both? Yes. Some of these are great for addressing both at the same time. The biggest thing with visual sensitivities, organization is key. Visual supports are key. Put a picture of where it needs to go. Have a picture checklist. Put numbers and letter lines down. This talks a little bit about using lamps instead of overhead lighting. Touch screens instead of a computer mouse. Use the iPad versus a PC. And also let the student determine their space. They may need to look at a blank wall instead of your gorgeous blackboard that you decorated for Christmas. That's really important to have a very organized visual space. I have to have my desk very organized. That helps me function. I can't look at my husband's desk. It drives me crazy. However, what he has to do periodically when he's working from home is reorganize it so everything is visually marked. Auditory sensitivities. headphones are okay. I used to have a real problem with people wearing headphones and kids wearing headphones all the time, but it's so much a part of our culture now. Let them wear them. Even if it's not connected to anything, it's not going to hurt anything. Always more visuals than words. I talk a lot and I like to talk. That's not always appropriate. Sometimes you have to edit yourself before you work with a student with auditory sensitivities because you may be the source of the distraction. Also, music. We had low-level music played at different parts of my classroom to help with that. So the next one. We'll give it just a second. And these are all things that you can do at home too. I tried to pick tips that were good for the classroom and for the home. So tactile sensitivities. One big thing is acknowledge the student is uncomfortable. That's okay. It's really important to play around with types of clothing. I cut a lot of labels out of people's clothes. It's okay to have a fidget all the time. If you come to a professional training, especially in the education and the corporate world, everybody's got something in their hand. Today, the fidgets on my desk include a unicorn that if I touch it will go off and sing a song. I have a little lighted gnome. Anything like that is fine. Non-traditional seating. Why does everybody have to sit in a chair? Can you sit, are you more comfortable on the floor, in a bean bag, sitting on a pillow, standing up? That's all okay. In regards to weighted vest, utensils, the brushing method, it's really, really important to talk to an occupational therapist, either through your child's school, or there are free parent chats online. And I think I shared that in my handout. That talks a little bit more about this. But the reason you want an occupational therapist involved is to make sure you're not creating additional sensory challenges. All right, we can move to the next one. And for a fun hot and cold, my husband just came back into work in our room, which is colder than the rest of the house because I tend to be really hot. He is currently wrapped up in a hoodie with the hood on. So everybody has sensory challenges. One thing with taste, number one, always keep those poisonous substances locked up safely. Talk with a nutritionist. Read some nutritionist blogs about diet. There's a lot of things that you can do with those taste sensitivities to make sure, even with a restricted diet, students are still getting the nutrients they need. Also, have a cooking time and use the foods they already like. We had cooking Fridays every Friday, and we always picked something that everybody would enjoy. It got real creative sometimes, but that's really important. Work with the strengths. I think that's really key. All right, we'll go ahead and move to the next couple of slides. And I told you I like to talk. I just realized what time it is. So I'm going to try to, I really want to get to that one slide with a couple of tips and tricks for you guys to access. Smells, scented lamps, if they like certain smells. If they don't like certain smells, get rid of it. Kleenex, allow a kid to hold the Kleenex up to their nose. You know, I use scent-free laundry products. I don't wear perfume. I wear lightly scented deodorants. It's just a balance. All right, we can go to the next slide. All right. Vestibular sensitivities, this is slow down. Slow down those movements from up to down. Let kids sit on something that wiggles. Lots of breaks. you know, mark stuff right side and left side. Nothing wrong with that. Merry-go-rounds, hanging upside down, do things that allow them to practice their movement. And then the last one is going to be those proprioceptic sensitivities. And again, that's one of those things with proprioceptic. I do recommend talking to your physical therapist or your occupational therapist, again, to make sure we're addressing the sensory need appropriately, and not getting weighed down by that. I know that sometimes my student would like to swing, but we would go too far, and then we send him really into a sensory meltdown unintentionally. Again, back and forth movements in a swing or a rocking chair, stress balls, fidgets, bubblegum in the freezer. That used to freak me out, but it's great. It's a slow chew. Pretzels, carrots, licorice sticks, Twizzlers, Skittles are great for this because they're chewy. And the biggest thing that I really recommend this to teachers, to parents, do not take physical education or recess away from a student. Those students that really need deep pressure or running or jogging or just need a break from the routine, don't take that away. There's research that shows that that's not meaningful. There's other ways to provide reinforcement for those behaviors that we want instead of taking things away. All right, let's go to the next slide. And on this next slide, in your handout and on the PowerPoint, each of these pictures will link to some actual activities that are easy to do at home and at school. The picture with myself there at the computer, when you click on that, it goes to understood.org that gives you 25 easy tips to address sensory needs, both hyper and hypo. And it's a quick and easy way to do some things to help you through this time, whether you're at home or in the classroom. The center link is to the Kentucky Autism Training Center that is housed at the University of Louisville. It is a link to a more in-depth training for teachers and parents on sensory needs, and they go through some video examples as well. It's a great training and information. It is about 2 hours long, but if you're interested, they have that information there. And then the last one is this neat little book that I discovered about a year ago called This is Gabriel, Making Sense of School. And it is a book for children about sensory processing disorders. And it walks through all of the different things that a student may experience and how it's handled both in a good way and a bad way. I recommend if you have a student with sensory processing challenges or needs, it is worth the, I think, $10 investment to get that book. It's a great way for looking at things, and I've been encouraging my teachers that I work with as well to take a look at this book. So I think the next slide is a thank you and my contact information. And please feel free to reach out to me. If I'm not able to answer your questions, I will hook you up with the person that you need to be in contact with. Are there any other questions, Stella?
Yes, we have one. It says, hang on, let's switch to your contact page. My child is hypersensitive to food, taste, and smells, but chews constantly on non-food items such as clothing, plastic, etc. Could this be a sensory processing difficulty?
Yes, most definitely. That is definitely something you want to talk to your doctor about. And the reason being is if she's choosing plastic eraser type materials, that can be a sign of she may need a little bit of a vitamin, like a gummy vitamin. It could be that with that sensory processing, she needs to have access to something chewy all the time, that is like gummy, or crunchy. But definitely talk with your doctor, talk with your occupational therapist, talk with your school. It's super easy. The very first on that understood.org, there is a whole thing about that actual issue and some ways to address it at home. Check that out. And if you have questions, just reach out to me at this email address.
It looks like maybe one more. At what point should a parent be concerned regarding a child displaying sensory issues?
Once those sensory issues are impacting the student's ability to function. So what that means is if they are having so many sensory issues, they can't get their work done, they can't concentrate, they can't communicate, etc. That is the moment where you should be having a much more in-depth conversation about sensory processing needs.
That's great. Thank you so much, Amanda. I want to just
Thank you. Just
let everybody know that every Tuesday we are doing webinars at 11 a.m. just like this. And on Tuesdays, we call them Kentucky Spins Tuesday Tips. So they will all be focused around different topics that will be in a tip-related format. And then on Thursday, we offer additional webinars on a variety of topics. And then on our webpage, we are always updating our webpage regularly with all things COVID-19. We have a specific page that has all the education updates regarding COVID-19, what schools are doing now. And so that's a really good page to go to. And then we also have an e-news that we send out every couple of weeks that has wonderful resources and information that you can sign up for on our website for that too. But again, I wanted to thank Amanda for being with us today and what great information this was. Oh my goodness, such great resources. And remember, when you get the email this afternoon, if you didn't get a chance to download the PowerPoint and handout, you can then, and it will have all those links that she was talking about, links to the resources mentioned in the presentation today. So you will get all that in a follow-up email later this afternoon. When you do sign off here in a few minutes, if you'll complete the evaluation for us, that will be wonderful. And thank you again, Amanda. And I hope everyone has a wonderful Thanksgiving. And we will not have a webinar this Thursday, of course, because of Thanksgiving, but we will start back up next week. So thank you all so much, and everyone have a wonderful day.
Thank you, Stella.
Thank you. Bye-bye.